Nightcap with your Judy GLJ. And today we have the amazing Renaissance man, the trade on Renaissance man, Mr. Kelly Greene. He's an author, writer, poet, blogger, and activist. Today is going to be all about the men. We're going to talk about men, what they like, what they want, a lot of different issues. So we're going to go ahead and jump right in. How you doing today?
I'm doing great.
That's really good. Beautiful day out. Thank you so much for coming.
Oh, you know, for you anytime.
Oh, I appreciate that. So we're going to start off with something that's dear to my heart, sports. I'm a big sports fan, as you know. And I know it's a little old, but let's talk about those finals.
Oh, my son is crushed.
Is he?
Yeah.
So you were going for, were you guys going for the Cavaliers?
He's a big LeBron fan.
Okay, okay.
I just like a good game. So being a former athlete myself,
yeah,
I really get the X's and O's. And
Detroit Renaissance man,
yeah.
Former athlete too. I'm sorry, I didn't throw that in there.
I did it all.
Nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong with that. So what did you think about the outcome of the series? Did you think that the Warriors were going to win?
I thought slightly they were going to win.
Slightly? Really?
The game was so even.
Do you think so?
With Kevin Love going out, it was kind of dead even.
Do you think so? Really?
Yeah, it was dead even.
That's
you didn't
crazy.
See that? Yeah.
Absolutely not.
Because if you look, Klay Thompson did not show up.
Yeah, that's true.
And with Kyrie Irving and Stephen Curry, that was almost dead even. But you put LeBron up against the rest of the Golden State Warriors squad, that was even.
Okay, so but you said LeBron. That's the reason why I said it wasn't even. LeBron is
right.
Even, but the whole team. Day of the first game of the finals, I announced that the Warriors is going to win in six. Everybody thought that's crazy.
No, you're right.
Yep, they
he's right.
So I just want to let everybody know I know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, you did. Yeah, you're absolutely right.
Absolutely. I think, though, I didn't say that they were going to win because I'm not a LeBron fan. I think LeBron is amazing.
Right.
I think people are so crazy and so hard on him. It's amazing how they go hard on him. And this man had like 40-plus points in all the games, except the last game.
Well, LeBron has owned pariah in that way. He is such a force on the feet, on the court.
Mm-hmm.
He's such a not liked person off.
But why? He seems so. I mean, what does he do? Why do you think that is?
We've had Jordan. And then once Jordan kind of like fade out.
So people don't want to.
Yeah, they had Kobe come up.
Yeah, so they don't want to get. They don't want to let him come.
You can't
Kobe
let.
Come.
Yeah.
That's so crazy. Get over it, people. I mean, I'm not a Cavaliers fan.
All right.
I'm a Celtics fan and a Pistons fan. All right. The man is great.
Yes, he is.
Yeah, he is.
Yes, he is.
All right, so we're going to jump to my next favorite sports, which is it's football. But unfortunately, last season, seemed like it was a big surge in domestic violence. And I'm sure this is not the only time it's been a surge, but now social media, you know, video and all those things show it more. What do you think? It looks like, from my notes here, from 2005, there were like 14 players.
Uh-huh.
14 players arrested for domestic violence. You have Ray Rice, Ray McDonald, Chris Cook from San Francisco, Tony McDaniel, Kevin Williams in Seattle, Brandon Marshall, Santonio Holmes, Greg Hardy from the Panthers, Dez Bryant, Eric Walden, Dante Witter, Randy Starks, and Frosty Rucker of the Arizona Cardinals. Now, out of all of them, all of them are still playing except Ray Rice. What do you think about that? The whole Ray Rice, him not playing, do you think that domestic violence should be a factor in whether or not you are able to stand on this type of stage?
It should, absolutely.
I agree.
Problem is, before now, that number would probably be higher.
Oh, absolutely.
I mean, you're talking about from, and I would say since I started watching football, I was like 60 to my 70s. Being an NFL wife is very hard. Especially,
absolutely.
You know, your husband, he's gone most of the time.
Right.
Then when he's back, he really doesn't connect with you that often. What you're doing.
Do you think it's because the sport is so violent, or do you think that just those people are just those people? That's just what they do.
Well, I don't think sport is violent.
Yeah.
But you have to look at the money they make and the way they're treated.
Okay.
They're treated like celebrities. Treated
like
humans. And
absolutely.
So once the wife says, hey, you know, you need to do this at home, or this is what I want. He's like, nah. My house, my rules.
Right.
You're going to treat like everybody else treat
me. Yeah.
And you got to
learn. I can see that.
It's a problem.
The whole, you know, the reason why I think Ray Rice was the only one out of all of those 14 who is no longer in the league because his was caught on tape.
Yeah.
I mean, it was horrible. Don't get me wrong.
Yes.
It was
horrible. Super
horrible. You know, I can't say anything about the fact that she stands next to her man through all of this. But it is what it is. You know, I don't understand the logic behind it, but I don't have to live that life. But the reason why I think he was the one that is no longer playing is because it was caught on tape. But I think that that's crazy. I think that if it's proven, because allegations come all the time, if it's proven, then I think that it should, that you shouldn't be able to do this and be that this type of famous, this type of celebrity, and do this type of platform, and also beat up on your wife or whomever, whether it's your wife or anybody else. And I don't think it's just a man and woman thing, because we have the WNBA players who were married, and they domestic violence as well. But the problem with that is that's the double standard, because nobody even talks about that.
On
this type of stage, right? You talk about domestic violence
and domestic violence. Well, it should be transparent through all sports.
Right.
Not just NFL, NBA, Major League Baseball.
Absolutely.
It has to be a standard across the board.
I agree. And it hasn't been for so long. I mean, these type of things, and as somebody who knows the back behind the scenes of some type of sports, this is not anything new.
These things were
covered up by the teams, the management, the agents. The only reason why it's been such a big deal is because Ray Rice got caught on tape. Now it has put the eye spotlight on everybody else. And, you know, NFL, you know, they messed up at first.
Yeah.
Kelly Blue messed up at first. He didn't act like he didn't know what's going on. But still, we all know he knew he was going on. But they did come back, and they started this whole, you know, domestic violence NFL program. Which is a good thing, but I think it needs to be more than showboating.
It's still messing up even now, because it had Hardy's suspension just got reduced down to four games.
I know. Because it's all about that almighty dollar.
And if you're a great player,
that's all that matters. Think about it's not domestic violence, but what's his name in New England?
Tom Brady?
No, not Tom Brady.
Other guy. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, he killed people. Yeah. But the crazy thing with that is he had so many issues in the past, but the team covered them all up because he was such a great player.
Yeah, Hernandez was.
And it's crazy. It's all about the money.
Hernandez is a poster child for entitlement.
Exactly. Exactly.
But they make them
entitled.
You know,
the team owners, the sponsors, they make them entitled. Because when these type of things happen the first time, I say, we're going to cut you off right now.
And, you know, and then about a lot of African American protesters, and, you know, as you say, well, get this guy another chance. You'll have a chance to be a billionaire.
Absolutely.
Why are you going to mess that up?
What are you talking about? Get another chance. I agree, but, you know, I think that when it comes to our race, we tend to look at it with rose-colored glasses, even though we shouldn't.
Right,
you know,
exactly.
It's, you know,
because we've been downtrodden so long.
We've been downtrodden, but you know, that doesn't mean that anybody gets passed.
No,
I don't care who you are. You know, it is, if you've done this, then you have to own up to it, and you have to suffer the consequences.
Exactly. There's no
reaction.
Because once you get so far, like we talk about entitlement, we talking about other sort of the 1% how they're getting entitled.
Yeah.
We try to transfer that to lower economy, especially in black community.
Yeah.
It doesn't translate because you don't get the same chances.
Right,
you know?
Exactly.
One, your first mess up, it's a wrap. You have to appreciate a lot more. They don't appreciate it.
But that's my thing, and you would think that we would. Well, we got to do better.
We got to do a lot
better. You know, I think that the whole domestic violence issue is an issue that needs to have more light shed on it.
Oh, yeah.
It needs to be shown as what it is. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? A lot of people cover it up or downplay it.
Right.
You know, it's not that serious, or if this person allowed it, it's okay. Mm-hmm. It's still not okay.
No, because if you look at it's not so many good stories, especially when you talk about Tina Turner.
Yeah, absolutely.
And you talking about, and she says, and it's now different from, you know, a lot of other women. If you got your husband successful, And you got people in her family telling like, okay, if he hits you, so what? You're rich.
Yeah. And the crazy thing is, you seen that in the Tyler Perry movie, a couple of Tyler Perry movies. Yeah. People do that.
They do all the time. All the time. Yeah, they say he's rich, so just,
people,
you know.
Do it all the time.
No, he's knocking you around. You're not, you can be rich and swole up. It's not, it doesn't add up.
Right. So do you think that when it comes to violence in relationships, I'm going to specifically speak about our race, and I'm not going to say wife and husband, husband and wife, but when it comes to violence within our community, period, do you think that we look at it with rose-colored glasses instead of looking at it the way it really should be looked at?
I think we're desensitized to it because a lot of us grew up violently, you know, especially if you're African-American and so much of your history is violent.
You think that's it?
Yeah, we don't give it the due attention because we're so desensitized to it.
See, you know, I think that's true in some cases, but, you know, I grew up in the hood.
Yeah.
But my hood wasn't like the hood these days.
It wasn't.
It's a different standard. It's a different... There is no standard anymore. Right. There's no...
we have standards.
There's no rules. Yep. You know, even the streets had rules back then.
Yeah.
You know, men, women, those type of things were, you know, children, those type of things you didn't do.
Right.
These days it's completely different. I think that as a community, when it comes to violence, I think that we need to take take those glasses off and we need to start keeping it real. It's at the point of no return to me.
Well, another thing is a point of no return because there has to be a return.
Yeah.
There has to be the dialogue, but we have to get into our youngest people. I get into my son, even he's 13, and he's a long way away from relationships or whatever. I was like, look, this you don't do.
Right.
And even when the Ray Rice situation broke, I said, and I made him watch it, like, look.
That's good.
You don't do this, because it's going to cost him his career.
That needs to be just done more often.
Yeah, and the thing about Ray Rice, he did it at a point where his career was almost over. Being a running back at 3 years, you already old man at that point.
Right.
So why would you do anything to jeopardize that, let alone anything to a woman who's supposed to take care of you going into your later years of your life?
Yeah.
And it's like, you can't do that. Once you start being violent towards that woman who's, say, you know, I do, you're going to be with, you can do whatever to anybody else.
Yeah,
you know,
absolutely.
Absolutely.
Anybody's fair game. I think that the problem, one of the things that it was missing from that whole Ray Rice situation, and maybe all of the situations, is where's the counseling? Where's the, let's find out why he would think it's okay to punch this woman and drag her out of it.
And
no matter what she, no matter what went on, don't get me wrong, I'm going to say, oh, she shouldn't have put it, she can put her hands on him. No, please believe, ladies, don't put your hands on nobody. Yeah. Because you shouldn't. However, he really knocked her out.
Yeah. But you,
you know,
see,
he needs some help. Something is wrong for you to think that that's okay to hit a woman that way.
It goes back to the entitlement.
Yeah.
Everybody kissing my butt, you going to fall in line, I'm going to knock you out.
I'm going to knock you out. I agree. You're right.
Yeah. And
entitlement will do that.
There's another situation with a kid from Florida State that just came out like about a week ago. That situation I'm a little different on, because she did hit him first and he kind of tried to defuse it. He had grabbed her and like, look, you know, try to hold her.
Right. He didn't. I agree, because it wasn't he didn't beat her up.
Right.
I agree.
And then when she let her go, she gave him one to the eye. And the kid, you react and you feel like you're being attacked. Even if it's a woman, somebody hit you. There's something,
I think you have to get out those situations, though. I think that
we don't train people to,
yeah, I agree.
Nobody came here and say, okay, you're in this situation.
Walk away.
Right.
This person's not who you're supposed to be with.
This person will take you down.
Right.
Just
being
them.
Right.
They have nothing to lose. You do.
Right. Because she is at fault as well. All
right.
That all of that is, you know, violence, period, is something that doesn't need to happen. You can't put your hands on somebody and expect for nothing to, to happen to you. However, the men have to realize, okay, I have to walk away from this woman.
Right.
Two, do I need to be with somebody who makes me want to put my hands
exactly.
on them?
Exactly.
You know, everybody needs to, you know, sit down and take a look at the situation and make some quick decisions.
Yeah, there has to be somebody that talks to you at some point in time in your life and say, you know what, even if you're provoked, this is how you handle a situation, this is how you not handle a situation.
Gotcha.
If nobody's in your life to tell you that at any point in time, okay, here you are, you will fall into that category. You will act out and you will lose.
I agree. Thank you. Great conversation regarding my sports. I got a quick question for you before we go. Real quick question. Who are you picking? NFL coming back. Starting next in August. Come on.
I don't ride my Lions, but.
Okay, you're riding with your Lions because they're your Lions. I respect Lions. That.
I had to say off-season moves, coaching, I still like the Patriots.
I hate the Patriots.
I know, even with Tom Brady sitting.
I hate them. Only because they used to beat my Steelers all the time. Yes, I am bitter.
Yeah, very bitter. But at the top.
I'm bitter. Do you think so?
At the top.
I'm thinking, I don't know. I'm a Steelers fan, and I'm going with Green Bay. But I'm going to go with Green Bay because I think they can come back and then come back.
They are good.
All right.
They are good.
All right, so we're going to go ahead and take a break. We'll be right back. Okay, Kelly.
Uh-huh.
So, I hear all the time women say that there are no more good men, good black men left.
Uh-huh.
When you hear that, what do you think?
They ain't looking for them. They're not. They're not looking for them, and they're not really wanting them. I'm gonna brag on my nephew and my little cousins for
that's all right. That's what you're supposed
because
to.
We raised them. Perfectly. Mm-hmm. They're in their mid-20s, no kids, college educated guys.
Same with my son, absolutely. I hear you.
And then, but when they go out, when I hear them talking about women, I'm like, are you serious? I mean, they talk to you like that?
The
way women talking like that, okay. Then. My nephew is really laid back guy, mm-hmm. So he's like they call him soft. I'm like,
because he's laid back.
Yeah.
So you think that your opinion is that the women who are saying that,
all right,
they're looking for a good black man. Your nephew is one, my son's one, but because they are on track, they're soft. They're not the black. They're not really looking for what they're saying. They're looking
exactly.
For.
Exactly. It's what they're saying one thing, expecting another thing.
Okay.
And sometimes it goes by age range as well.
Yeah.
If you go like, I say, maybe 30 and ups, mm-hmm. They're actually looking for good black men, but they run into they're not really looking for good as far as having stuff together, doing what he's needed to do, taking care of, and involved in his community.
Mm-hmm.
But they see that guy other places.
Right.
But in their everyday life, they see pants sagging. I got two or three baby mamas.
That's not going to happen.
Exactly.
You can't even talk to me with your pants sagging. I ain't way too old to come up to me like that.
Oh, yeah. And then, that's what they see.
Right.
I mean, that's what they live around, but they don't know where they want to find the other guy.
Okay.
They're not expanding their horizons.
Okay. So do you think that any parts of that, them, and I agree with you. I think that there are a lot of good men, period. Black, white, whatever. I think that there are good men, period. Right. I think that a lot of women claim that they want that, the right guy, the Prince Charming. Prince Charming can come along, right. But if he's not, like you said, if he's not sagging or if he's not that, in that mold that they see visually,
right.
They don't even look past the visual. That's all they see.
Right.
However, I do think that, on the other hand, that there are some issues today with our black men, and not all, but some. And I think some of that also falls on the women because today I look at the way our women present ourselves, the vibe that we give off, all those things is a bit different. But as somebody who's single, running into or dating, it is kind of hard. And when I say good, I don't mean good as in perfect.
Okay.
I mean good as in respectful, out looking for a good woman.
Right.
Not just some of a good woman, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
You know?
Exactly.
And it's real, though. Uh-huh. It's crazy that, and the reason why I say that it's a problem is because I get inboxes all the time. And it's crazy that you think that you can inbox me or DM me or even meet me face to face for the first time and your first question is a sexual question. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
But on on, it's very disrespectful, but it happens so often you would not understand.
Oh, no, I totally, I've heard stories and...
It's crazy.
I actually had a friend of mine actually screenshots from things that, you know, I was like,
yeah,
really?
I mean,
is this the level of dating now?
It is. Believe me, it is. I think that social media is the club, the dating scene, you know, to people these days. It's crazy, but I think that part of the problem, I won't put it all on the men. I think they do what they have been allowed to do.
And
so many
like
women
that.
Allow it, and then, you know, you have a picture of what you, every picture of you is from behind, you know, what you right. expect that guy is going to be,
exactly.
you know. But when it comes to, like, I think that the amount of respect for relationship is no longer there. I don't know if it's just a black man thing or if it's just a relationship thing.
It's a culture thing. Our culture's changed. Now, let me make it, if I could do a demonstration.
Mm-hmm.
When our grandparents were dating,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
now my grandparents are from Mississippi.
Mm-hmm, mine too.
If you look at the pool they had to pick from, maybe this big.
True.
Okay, now.
True. That makes a lot of sense.
Well, my father, you know, he's from Mississippi, so, but you know, you're talking about years later.
Ooh,
pool was just a little bigger.
Right, now.
Right, then, so me and my brother, you know, live in Detroit. Pool's a little bit bigger. We have some access, you know.
Right. Yeah,
but now you got social media.
Yeah.
Social media, pool is this big.
Right, everywhere.
And people everywhere. Have a hard time making that. Adjusting to the pool being this big,
mm-hmm.
but then by when your pool is this big,
mm-hmm.
Who you are has to stand out.
Right.
Because let's say you're a good woman over here, and the good man that you're ideally supposed to be with is over here.
Right.
Unless you stand out, he won't see. Because you have all these women who want to do whatever.
For anything.
Get to him.
Right. I agree. I think that's a great analogy, a great way of putting it. I think that there are so many... The ratio from men to women is so different. It's
exactly.
so lopsided.
Exactly.
There's no balance. So that there is, but when it comes to being a good man, is it the man's responsibility to say, okay, yes, this pool is huge, but
uh-huh.
I still need to man up and do what I need to do?
Well, men, we are visual.
We are too. I don't think y'all know that, but go ahead.
I didn't find out until after I get married, but so
we are.
We, you know, a lot of times a man will say, "Well, I am this is a good man. I have these standards. I've
mm-hmm.
worked hard,
mm-hmm.
made myself presentable and in good standing."
Right.
But I don't have those same standards for the woman I want in my life.
Right.
So that's where the problem comes in.
Yeah.
If he doesn't have those same standards,
yeah, right.
he gonna, you know, highlight every hood rat just cause she cute, wrong. Whatever.
Right.
Or she on Facebook page, she got her butt stand out. He's like, I want that butt in my life. I don't care what else going on. I want
that butt right there.
And that's where the problem comes in, cause now he's not looking at the other good woman. He's looking at him.
Right, he's looking at that butt.
That butt
has blocked everything. I agree with you. It's a sad thing. But I feel like I tell a lot of women who say that to me that if that's the case, that means you just haven't found the one for you. I don't think it's necessarily the fact that they're good or bad.
Right.
They're just not the one for you. Mm. You know, I mean, if he's not doing the things that you need in your life, then that person is not the one for you. You're not the one for him, so
right.
keep it moving.
Right.
I think we have to stop putting it on our color, you know,
yeah,
black. You
exactly.
know, it's just good, period. Good,
period.
Bad, period.
Right.
But I do want to ask you a question, which to me, I think it seems to be... something that I have noticed lately within the past couple of years. Do you think there is a fear of marriage amongst men? If so, why?
Because if you get divorced, you're broke.
Is it? You think that's the only thing in the divorce part?
Well, I think
that's
not.
A good thing. Because if you get divorced,
you're broke.
Maybe stop taking it.
Right. Right. But anybody, it's been so many bad marriages.
Yeah.
So by the time... You're at the point where you're thinking about getting married, you're like, do I really want to do all that?
Yeah.
Don't want to do that to myself. Well, everybody, let's say all the men in your family have been through really bad divorces, and, you know, eating ramen noodles and living hotel rooms, and it's like, dang, don't want to put my all to a woman who might, at the same time, cheat on me or leave me or and I'd be back to square one. That's a big fear.
I think that's a different perspective. I apologize to let you know that I had a completely different thought. My thought was mostly of being with one woman forever was the fear.
We could do that.
You think so?
Yeah, we could do that hands down, but then about it. A lot of times, especially when I'm cheating, a lot of women had, oh, the men cheat, do this. Mm-hmm. We had the exact same stories about women.
And sometimes that. I wrote a book worse. About that called Creeping. Y'all need to go get that.
Yes, do that.
I agree.
A lot of times, our stories are worse because, and I've been through it. I had one, you know, I was dating. You know, if you find out she cheated on you, then she said, oh, I had a baby, and the baby ain't yours. And like,
wow, well, yeah, that's deep.
I mean, it does mind intrigue on
you. I'm sure. So I've never looked at it that way, as the way you put it, which gives me a different perspective. And I hope that it gives some of the women who have those same thoughts the same perspective. My next question was, do you think it's hard for men to be faithful? And when I say hard, I mean, everybody has temptation.
Oh, yeah.
Believe me, I know temptation very well. I'm sure we all do. All
right.
But I think that it's always an excuse. I hate to hear people say, you know, a man is going to be a man. I think that's an excuse. I think that's bullshit.
It's totally cop out.
Yeah.
Total
cop out. Absolutely.
Any man be faithful if you are the woman he wants to be faithful with.
I believe that.
And think about it, women get to a point where this is the man I want, and I'm going to make him be what I want to be.
Right,
but
right.
If he is not ready for all that,
he's going to do. I agree.
So
I absolutely agree. We were talking about that on one of the last shows. Girl talk about how women try to force the situation. If he's continuously cheating on you again, let's go back to he is not the one for you.
Exactly.
And vice versa.
Yeah, especially.
You have to make that decision and keep it moving.
And it cracks me up sometimes when I go places and I overhear women talking. Mm-hmm. And, you know, hear women talking about, well, I got this other guy on the side. He cashed me out and buying me. And being about it.
Baby, stop talking. Yeah. People be listening.
I mean, and think about women, men hear this.
Yeah.
You never know who listens, so.
Yeah. Women, I don't know about men, but women are notorious, you know. They have a team.
Yeah, we know we have a team. We've been team members. We know how
to go. You know what? See, my thing is this. My thing is, when it comes to all of that, I just think that whether it's a man, whether it's a woman, I think that you have to keep it real.
Uh-huh.
If you're going to be in a relationship with someone and you are still going to see other people, then you just need to keep it real.
Right.
And let that person play the game if that's the game they want to play.
Exactly.
You know, you can't just do it behind, because that's when you have all kind of problems. Can't tell a woman, oh, I'm gonna be with you, I love you, and then you still want to cheat. Be real about it, because that's when you get the Jasmine Sullivan's out and acting crazy.
Slash the tires and whatnot.
Right, and you're like, this shit crazy. You shouldn't have did what you did. You should let her go a long time ago. You knew that wasn't what you wanted.
Right, and think about it now, I know some married men are hot commodities now.
You know,
And I had to say it, because ain't no. I gotta be real, married men are hot commodities.
But listen, I've talked to women who date married men, and I always ask, you know, what is it that makes a married man the right one for you to date? And they always say, because I don't have to deal with him no more. I deal with him here.
Mm-hmm. I've heard that.
She has to deal with all that. Mm-hmm. I don't have to deal with him more. It's crazy, but I think that it's a lot of people who are okay with that kind of relationship. Mm-hmm. Either way, but that's a deeper.
That's another show.
but it's real, and it is another show. Absolutely, uh-huh. But it's real, and I think that a lot of people need to, again, even if you're married, you need to be real about it.
Right.
This is what I am. This is what I do. And as the woman who makes that choice to be the other woman, you have to understand. There's always consequences to anything. So, you know, if she finds out, when she comes, you know, she comes for you, you know she's coming for you. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah.
Know that that's going to happen.
Yeah.
Know that karma is real as well. I believe that seriously. Anything, karma is real. And me, I guess I'm spoiled. I don't want to share.
No.
I need you to be able to do everything I need you to do. So I can't have time for nobody else. I'm a little too spoiled for all that.
Another crazy thing is, because like you talk about social media, I've gotten inboxes when they inbox me. And the first time it happened, I was just like freaked out, like, who's you? You know? But once
and I know that you're married, though.
Yeah, and know it. Know it.
Listen, this guy inboxed me, and yes, I'm going to mention it. I'm not mentioning the name, but he inboxes me. I'm going to say this real quick. And his inbox is, you know, he wants, oh, you're so fine. It's beautiful. I want to see you. I'm going to fly you here. He's in another place. So I immediately go look at his page, and I'm like, married, you know, married to. I go back in there, and I gave him the business. Yeah, oh, if anybody knows me, I can give you the business. I get,
Real quick.
Are you serious? Mm-hmm. But the fact that you have that gall is amazing. But so many women allow it.
Allow it.
It's just on both ends.
Yeah.
Nurture it.
So it did by me, once I started writing and my name started getting out there, I had to realize that it's discipline come with it.
Yeah, discipline comes with all of it. I think that's the key with everything, discipline and respect.
Yep.
All right, we're going to go ahead and take a break. We'll be right back.